The song I'm about to sing is entitled, Let the Weight of Your Glory Fall. Do we truly desire it? Do we really want it? Are we going to let the things of this earth occupy us and consume us, or the things of God? That's a question for you to consider. And we ask God now to let His glory fall.
To see you reveal your glory in the That your people have come into your house this very day. It is not by happenstance that you have given a message today, this hour. For Lord, you are the one that told me what to preach. As we have prepared, Lord, it's apparent there is a precise reason why you chose to have this today. So, Lord, as we come by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we come into your house be taught by you. Glorify your name, that we may surely understand without a iota of doubt and how you are leading your people on a firm foundation that cannot be altered. Glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen. It is a extremely serious problem when God's people have rejected His leadings and teachings in our past. But the reality is this: most Seventh-day Adventists have no concept that they are actually rejecting God. Today we will be addressing a deception authored by Satan himself. This deception has been accepted as truth for almost 75 years in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. In almost every circle, whether it be in the mainline church, self-supporting churches, all across the world, whether it be liberal or conservative, this deception has been believed and defended. The problem is when ministers receive their training in an apostate system with distorted, corrupted theology by professors who were also taught from material contradicting God's truth. We must be humble enough to acknowledge when the deception is exposed. We must unlearn that which we thought was truth. We must forsake that which we thought was truth. All of it. But then it's really more important we do something else also. Because if the first two are done and the next one is not done, you're just causing more problem. You see, then we must be willing to learn from God's designed methods. 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 10. Because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved, for this cause, rejecting the truth, God shall send strong delusions, that they believe a lie. Remember, after 75 years, it will be impossible to know whether you are deceived unless you are passionately loving the truth that God has given. Remember, you can think something is truth, but unless God has designed it and given it as truth, it could very well be a lie, thinking it's truth. So it has to be qualified. It has to be a love of the truth that God has given. Being so, you will be ever diligent to know and understand and apply the teachings of God in our past history. All this is what matters. We must receive the love of the truth. It must be coveted in our lives. Truth must be coveted. Few ministers, let alone the laity, really know what true Adventism is. Oh, they know apostate Adventism. But they don't know true Adventism. Why, you ask? It is because there is an extreme lack of knowledge in the writings of the pioneers that God has chose to establish the true message of Seventh-day Adventists. Recently, one minister right here in our church testified to me personally how it wasn't until he was forced out of the mainline church that he learned the world of truth revealed in the writings of the pioneers. Listen to God's prophet as she makes the statement. After suppositions, contrary to the light God has given, are to be entertained. Continuing, she says, few are still alive. Few are still alive. Though through the experience gained in the establishment of this truth, the standard bearers who have fallen in death are to speak through the reprinting of their writings. I am instructed. Now, when the prophet of God says, I am instructed, who's instructing her?
God is.
God is. I am instructed that thus their voices are to be heard. They are to bear their testimony as to what constitutes the truth for this time.
Amen.
Now this phrase, the truth for this time, could be restated as what?
Present
truth. It's synonymous. It's saying the same thing. Continuing. We are not to receive the words of those who come with a message that contradicts the special points of our faith. Because there are ministers that do it.
Amen.
And many do it not knowing that they are. Because they haven't read what the pioneers wrote. So they think they're saying something that is truth when it is really error. Then the prophet continues saying, while the scriptures are God's word and are to be respected, the application of them, if such an application moves one pillar from the foundation that God has sustained these 50 years, it would be what?
A great mistake.
Not a little mistake. A great mistake. A large mistake. He who makes such an application knows not the wonderful demonstration of the Holy Spirit that gave power and force to the past messages that we have come, that has come to the people of God. Reviewing. Look at it again. Number one. No after suppositions, contrary to what the pioneers established, are to be entertained. No means none. Zero. Nothing. Secondly, we are to reprint the standards, the standard bearers' writings are to be reprinted, to be heard, to be read. Thirdly, God instructed that this is what is truth for today. This is what is present truth. Fourthly, we are not to receive the words of any person that contradicts what God has given.
Amen.
The Bible, fifthly, the Bible is to be respected and the application of them by God's standard bearers. You know, there are a lot of ministries out there preaching a lot of stuff, but none of them are doing it according to the pioneers. They get their hobby horse and that's what they preach, but they're not doing it in the light of the pioneers. You see, Satan has destroyed an important last day event prophecy given by God concerning the last two chapters of Daniel. We must never forget God used the prophet not to establish present truth, but to confirm it and to clarify it when necessary.
Amen.
Notice what she wrote. Moses was chosen by God as the messenger of his covenant. The Lord called him up into the mountain to receive his instruction for Israel. Today God chooses men as he chose who?
Moses,
to be his messengers. And these men first receive instruction from God.
Not man.
Not from men. That's right. Not from men. From God. And then they are to impart that which they receive. It is a fearful thing to be like the murmuring Israelites, rejecting the men who God has chosen. You see, to reject or to ignore the writings of the men God chose to establish present truth is rejecting God, not the men.
Amen.
Just as the children of Israel rejected Moses and chose other people to lead them, don't think the same condemnation comes against you when you reject these men who wrote these works.
Amen.
Just because the earth hasn't swallowed you up yet don't mean it will. It won't. Because it will. concerning the Eastern question. Ellen White is silent completely. Why? It's because there is a host of pioneers who are all united in the interpretation of Daniel 11 and 12. Uriah Smith, James White, Stephen N. Haskell, Alonzo T. Jones, all are in unison with more than 500 pages written in their own hand. Why would the prophet need to say anything? You see, when we have two and three pioneers all agreeing in the establishing of the platform of truth, God says it's established by His authority. Deuteronomy 19:15 makes it clear. If you don't understand this, study it. At the mouth of two witnesses or of three witnesses shall the matter be established. Note what God's prophet wrote of Uriah Smith and his book, Daniel and the Revelation. Be advised that this quotation is speaking of the original manuscript, not the one published by the mainline church, who changed the manuscript as soon as, or very soon after, Uriah Smith died. This is not to be argued, this is a fact. When you have the original and the ones being printed today side by side, you can tell they have been changed. So don't come with me afterwards saying, oh, it's the same. No, it isn't. I have both. Those who are preparing to enter into ministry, who desire to become successful students of the prophecies, will find Daniel and the Revelation an invaluable help. They need to understand this book. It speaks of the past, present, and future, laying out the path so plainly that how many?
None
need to err therein. Those who will diligently study. Now, how do you diligently study? How do you diligently study? Okay, in other words, you don't do it just by a lazily attitude, do you?
No.
You do it with gusto. You do it with passion. Who diligently study what book?
Daniel
and the Revelation. Will have no relish for cheap sentiments presented by those who have a burning desire to get something out, something new and strange to present to the flock of God. The rebuke of God is upon all such teachers. And then she says something. Those teachers need that one to teach them what is meant by godliness and truth. In other words, this, when you start preaching things that go against Daniel and Revelation by Uriah Smith, you are basically under the rebuke of God. Not only that, she says you need to be taught correctly by men who know what is in that book. But let's go on, because it goes even deeper in the final aspect. It says, concluding here, this is what the prophet said. The great essential questions to which God would have presented to the people are found in Daniel and the Revelation. There is a solid, eternal truth for what time?
This time.
This time. Everyone needs the light and information it contains. Interesting. Now let's continue. Interest in Daniel Revelation is to continue as long as what?
Probationary time.
Probationary time shall last. Now this is the most important thing I want you to listen to. Because it's going to take you a while to understand what God is saying here in the prophet. God used the author of this book as a channel through which to communicate light and direct minds to the truth.
Man.
Shall we not appreciate this light which points us to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, our King? A channel to communicate light. From who?
God.
From God. In other words, God inspired Uriah Smith to write the book Daniel and the Revelation. And don't mess with it.
Amen.
Don't twist it. Just study it. God used Uriah Smith to reveal things in prophecy that Ellen White didn't. Remember, God's prophet wrote that God is the one who chooses men as he chose Moses. One can only conclude that Uriah Smith and others, God gave special insights and talents like he did Moses under inspiration. James White writes this, "The book of Daniel contains chains of prophecy which reach down to the end of earthly kingdoms and of the judgment. Chapters 11 and 12 are one chain, reaching down to the end of time when Michael shall stand up. The time of trouble which such as never was in the resurrection of many." Bible Adventism, page 73. So let's find out what the deception is. 1888 Bible Readings for the Home Circle, page 391. The 11th chapter of Daniel entire is a what kind of prophecy?
Literal historical.
A literal historical prophecy. The longest and the most remarkable of its kind in all of Scripture. Now, this particular study in the book, Bible Readings for the Home, was changed in the 1960s. Based on the writings of Lewis Weir, who took the new and previously never held position before 1940 that the King of the North was the papacy. Because everything in Daniel 11 was not literal, but spiritual. His works were dated in the early 1940s and 1950s. But they were based on another person's work, Elder Raymond F. Cottrell, who initiated the concept in 1943 that the papacy was the King of the North. Such a position had never before been advocated and certainly not a part of the platform of present truth as established by God since 1855 and 1905. Early writings, the prophet says, "Said my accompanying angel." Now, does the angel say anything of its own accord?
No. God forbid.
God forbid is correct. God the Father instructs the angel what to tell individuals when he go on a mission. So you could literally say here, God the Father, the sovereign Father of the universe, said this. "Woe to him who shall move a block or stir a pin of these messages. Keep that in your mind as we go through this today. With the angel, this means a statement come directly from the throne of God. Therefore, there is a woe from God against any man, any person, making the prophecy of Daniel 11 and 12 spiritual and not literal.
Amen.
Then concluding that the kingdom of the north is the papacy. It is removing and stirring the pin of the true Seventh-day Adventist foundational beliefs. No one can rightly defend that this is not removing and stirring a pin. It was never in the established truths of the church. And when a diligent student reads the original established pioneer position, they know it's been messed with.
That's right.
And since any pin removed from the foundation, any pillar moved, any pillar adjusted, opens up to every type of deception, and the whole collapses behind it, leaving most people who have either never have been or no longer on the platform. You see, you can be a professed Seventh-day Adventist today and not on the platform of God.
That's right.
Because if you are on an apostate system, believing in an apostate theology, you are not on the platform and you're not going to heaven. You're going to hell. You are not going to be saved believing a lie.
That's right.
You're only going to be able to be saved believing what?
Truth.
Truth. And not only just truth, but
present
truth. And that's where we must stand. There's a lot of people who profess to be on the platform that are not on the platform. Because such acts of believing grand deceptions on the part of Satan leaves one completely vulnerable. They're outside of Christ. They're outside of the hedge of protection. And their whole mind, their whole Bible study starts to become twisted. Not just on one truth, but in everything starts to be eroded. The unique message of the remnant church supposed to be preaching no longer becomes unique. An example to show how these men of influence cannot be trusted. Consider on the same page, to be considered even have the spiritual insight of these pioneers is absurd. When you listen to what our church has been doing and how we've been going over these past 100 years. The following is a quote from Elder Cottrell in 2002. It makes me want to throw up every time I read it. In the years immediately following October 22, 1844, the traditional sanctuary doctrine was an important asset for stabilizing the faith of the disappointed Adventist. Today, it is as equally significant liability and deterrent to the faith and confidence and salvation of biblically literate Adventist and non-Adventist alike. It was present truth following the great disappointment on October 22, 1844. It is not present truth in the year of our Lord 2002. Demonic forces inspired that man to write that. And yet, his theology is being defended as truth.
In the Adventist Church.
In the Adventist Church. Worldwide. You don't even know what truth is. God has spoken, saying Satan has used these men to begin to destroy the true platform of Seventh-day Adventists are to stand on, and I dare say it is all but completely destroyed. And you're standing on Swiss cheese, not a firm rock of foundation.
Amen.
Those who have believed the deceptive lies must confess and return to the platform. Unlearn what they have thought was truth and be taught after God's order and no one else's.
Amen.
You'd be better off to burn your degrees from the seminaries and not even claim to even been there. If we find ourselves as ministers believing the lies of Satan, we must acknowledge the error and quickly stand on truth or be in danger of greater use by demonic forces.
Right.
So what is the truth God established? You see, that should be the next question. See, I've made a statement, but I have not verified it yet, have I?
Not yet.
So the next question you need to ask is, okay, if the papacy is not the king of the north like I thought it was,
who is?
What is the truth? Time does not allow in discussing more than 500 pages of the pioneer writings. We would be here for a couple of weeks. Establishing the King of the North would take a long time. To do it the way the pioneers did, because they literally laid it out brick by brick, so that when you get down to the conclusion, there is no doubt. But in a quick few minutes, I'm going to give you a fast Learjet presentation on what they wrote. So put on your seat belts and let's go. The pioneers taught Daniel 11 as a literal prophecy. And in particular, the last set of verses in that chapter bring back into view the King of the North. So let us begin with verses 36 of Daniel 11 as being a direct reference to the papacy, which is completely false. Daniel 11, verse 36. Because this is the kingpin of why people say that it is the papacy that is the king of the north. Listen to what God said to his servant Uriah Smith. The king here introduced cannot denote the same power which was last noticed, namely the papal power. For the specifications will not hold good if applied to that power.
That's right.
Note. Take a declaration in verse 37. Nor regard any god. This has never been true of the papacy. Has the papacy ever said, we don't believe in God?
No.
No, they've never said that. So therefore, verse 36 cannot be the papacy, and verse 37 cannot be the papacy.
Correct.
And God and Christ, though often placed in false positions, now they have put them in false positions, never have professedly set aside and rejected in that system of religion. This is completely set forth in the writings of Uriah Smith and A.T. Jones, that verses 36 through 40 is identifying the king here as France.
Amen.
Amen.
And only can be France.
Amen. Everybody else.
Continuing. A.T. Jones, Marshalling the Nations, page 30, written in 1900. So when we come to the 40th verse of Daniel 11, we are not reading of the affairs way back in the days of the Empire of Greece, nor of the affairs of Rome, but of down here at the end of time, as mentioned in verse 35, and other verses also the same thing. And bear in mind that the king of the south is always in Egypt. And the king of the north is always the power that occupying the territory which Constantinople is the center. And all of the world knows that since 1453 AD, the territory which Constantinople is the center is held and ruled by who?
Turks.
The Turks, or Turkey. Then the king of the north, at the time of the end, which is when?
Now.
Right now, is the Turkish dominion, and no one else, and nowhere else.
That's right. Period.
Alonzo T. Jones in Bible Echo 1896 says this: as it is the Turkish power that now occupies Constantinople and holds the territory originally held by Lysimachus, the first king of the north, it is also plain enough that the Turkish power is the power referred to in the words, the king of the north, in the last five verses of Daniel 11.
Amen.
Presently today, the only thing that keeps Turkey in power is the kings of the east, which in reality are in part the United States and Britain. Which you're saying, Pastor, you are really confused up now, aren't you? Well, guess what? Read the book in the packet that we are going to give out. And you will find that, in fact, the United States and Britain are in the east. So far east that they are seen in the west, because you have a globe.
That's right.
And you keep going east far enough and you get where?
West.
You get west. Notice, in studying this truth, we will find this world will soon be in a war of slaughter that will make the World War I, World War II, and all modern wars combined look like nothingness. Why is this important? You're going to say, well, so what? Okay, now the Turkish power is the king of the north. So what? What does that have to do with me? Well, hopefully by the end of the day, you will know what it has to do with you. I would propose that it's extremely vital in correctly understanding this end time event, for it is directly linked with the close of probation, for the direct link of when your high priest stands up and said, he that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. And if you're not holy, you will be unholy.
Forever.
And not just for one day.
Forever
is right. Notice what Stephen N. Haskell in 1905 said. There is no date given for the fourth great waymark, namely when the capital of Turkey will be removed from Constantinople to Jerusalem, between the seas and the glorious holy mountain. This is being seen prophetically as intended, for Turkey has made it known they support the Muslim caliphate this very day. Now you're saying, what in the world is a Muslim caliphate? You see, we need to start understanding prophecy by how the pioneers set it up. And listen to the news, because the news can give you little bits and pieces here and there. And when you start studying, you're going, ah, now I get it. You see, when we see in world affairs the very prophetic declarations being made by God's inspired men that God chose to reveal truth to over 100 years ago, we should take serious notice. Repent if we find ourselves preaching, teaching, or even thinking anything contrary to the application of Bible prophecy authored by God and His men that He chose.
Amen.
Note, the Muslim world today is taking serious steps in establishing a one caliphate rule in the Arab world. They want it. Now, this just yesterday, I was learning about this, and it's not in my notes, but I'm going to tell you. In 1916, the Ottoman Empire united themselves with Germany. And the Allied forces went to some of the disenfranchised Arab sheikhs and said, if you will fight against the Ottoman Empire, we'll give you land and control. All to break that up completely and destroy it, undermine it. And so the Saudi Arabian sheikhs and others joined forces to destroy the caliphate that had been in place up until 1916. And the Allied forces had no intention of letting the Arabs have Jerusalem, even though that's what they were told they could have. In 1916, that's the reason why there's so much fighting right now. It's because all along they've been told, you can have Jerusalem. And they were turned away. And Israel was given that. In 1916, established in 1940s. They're upset. And they want their land. And now we come to the map. This is what their goal is. Not just to take the original 1916 agreement, but to take everything in the Middle East. The same demand which was used to establish the Muslim religion by Muhammad, the prophet, is being resurrected today. Be Muhammadan, pay tribute, or die, was the motto of the fighter for Muslim. The current question does not even allow for tribute. It says, only one thing, the Muslim way, the Sharia law, or you die. All to be under one caliphate, just as it was during the Ottoman Empire. The fact of the matter is recently in the news, a little tidbit was allowed through. Why, I don't know. Recently, it was allowed out that some factions in the Turkish government is actually using Turkish funds from the United States to fund ISIS to establish the caliphate. Right now, there are serious pressure being put on Turkey to close its borders and not allow literally a flood of money, arms, and people to go through the border of Turkey into the fighting zone. Note the two statements by Uriah Smith. In the closing verses of Daniel 11, the prophet depicts the scenes in history of a power now fast sinking into its inevitable doom, of a Turkish power as the king of the north. It is written, "He shall come to his end, and none shall help him. And at that time, Michael shall stand up, and that is to commence his reign." The question now is this: how near is the Turkish power to its utter extinction? Is the student of prophecies simply this? It can be said, how near is the setting up of God's eternal kingdom and our Lord Jesus Christ? To this question, we will let the politicians and the statesmen anywhere respond, and we will abide by the answer. I don't know how long this thing is going to work out. All I know right now is we have turmoil over there that's fulfilling prophecy. And if you are not right with Christ, if you are not standing on the platform that the pioneers have with blood, sweat, and tears established, you're lost. And I will not recant that. When God established His foundational beliefs through these men and you ignore them, how do you expect to know how to properly apply the Word of God?
Amen.
God didn't give them just to be, "Oh, these men are who established our church." They had an important role to play. And there's a blessing from the throne of God when we read and study this material.
Right.
When will the utter destruction of the king of the north happen? When probation closes. God has declared to the servant's writing in the context of the sixth plague, this is when it happens. I remember the first time I listened to the sixth plague being preached in an evangelistic sermon. I was 9 years old. And all it was spiritual foolishness then. And when I started learning this from a real, literal standpoint, I said, "Lord, help us as a people. This world is going to be in turmoil that is going to just frighten everybody to its core." The drying up of the river, in this sense, would be the consumption of the Turkish Empire, accompanied with more or less destruction of its subjects. Thus, we should have literal judgments upon men as the result of this plague, as in the case of all others. When these plagues fall, God systematically has each of these plagues come for a reason. They're not just happenstance plagues because He feels like destroying the world seven times in seven different ways. There are specific reasons, specific regions of the world, and the reason why the plagues hit these people is for a reason. The Bible prophecy will be fulfilled in this age of political correctness, with the laws to prevent genocide. God's judgment of punishment will happen. When the king of the north plants the tabernacles of his palace, the seas, between the seas and in the glorious holy mountain, a movement which is already behold in the initial steps. Uriah Smith wrote this in 1897. He saw it by faith then. Then Michael, our Lord, stands up or receives from his Father the kingdom preparatory to his return to this earth. Or it might have been expressed in the words like these: then our Lord ceases his work as our great high priest. There's a time when you cannot ask God for forgiveness of sin.
Amen.
Don't let any minister tell you that you can ask God for forgiveness anytime you want. No, there's a time when it gets cut off. There's a time no longer God will forgive sin. It's demonic forces. It's the Antichrist that tells you that Jesus will always forgive sin. It's the Antichrist that tells you, just come and confess, God will forgive you. No, there's a time when it no longer happens. Probation will close for the world. It will be finished. The great prophecies of the 2300 days gives us a definite commencement of the final division of the work of the heavenly sanctuary. The verse before us gives us data whereby we can discover approximately its close. October 22, 1844 was the beginning of the Day of Atonement. We can see on the horizon the day getting close to finishing. Are you one with Christ? Are you? Are you completely in cooperation with the Day of Atonement? Are you allowing Christ to finish his work in you so that you need not send sin to be forgiven? We should be loudly hearing the bells from the heavenly sanctuary of the robe of our high priest as he moves through the sanctuary. It should bring us to joy, but humble fear. Is there something left out of our lives that hasn't been confessed? Soon there won't be any time to confess anything. Have we made things right with our spouses? There's so much foolishness going on in homes today. We must be daily, unreservedly surrendering everything to our Heavenly Father's sovereign will, and don't let anything get by. We must be daily asking God to show us anything, Lord, that is contrary to your will. And don't stop praying the prayer. Pray for the trials that will perfect your character. Pray for that purification now. Without delay, we must be settled into the true present truth established by God's pioneers and nothing else. I want you to get a picture. I want you to contemplate it. The messages that God established as the foundation is for His church. And at this time, God is saying, if you will stand on this platform, I will make you the living stones of my temple. He builds His temple with you and I. But you've got to be on the right platform.
Right.
You've got to be on the right foundation, or you will not be a living stone. You'll be a dead rock.
Somewhere else.
They'll be burned in fire and brimstone. The only safe application of God's word is through the study of these pioneer men. This is not my private interpretation. And neither should it be anybody else's interpretation either that has learned from an apostate system. We must stand on the platform of God's truth, never man's devising inspired by Satan. Remember, it is Satan's object now to get up new theories to divert the mind from the true work and the genuine message for this time. Satan stirs up the minds to give false interpretation of Scripture and a spurious loud cry. There's a loud cry going out there that is not of God. There's a whole lot of baptisms going on in apostate Adventism. And Satan's loving every bit of it. I'm just praying every day, Lord, these people who are being brought into an apostate system, help them know what is truth. Daily I have people around the world asking me this question and that question. New Seventh-day Adventists. This is one of the greatest evidences that the loud cry will soon be heard. Too many times we are so afraid of offending when clearly there are things presented as truth which are completely contradicting what God has established as truth. God's servant defines how we should see it as Satan's work, and we need to call it by Satan's work. Well, no, not by this is your opinion or that's my... No. It's either God's work or it's Satan's work.
That's right.
It is clear to understand this. The principles of truth that God has revealed to us are our true foundation. That's the only one to stand on. It has made us what we are today. The lapse of time has not lessened their value. Just because Uriah Smith wrote it in 1897 does not mean it lessens by 117 years of being in the dust.
Right.
Get the book. The original one. By God's grace, soon this church we'll have them available.
Right.
The lapse of time has not lessened their value. It is the constant effort of the enemy to remove these truths from their setting and to place in their place spurious theories. Satan will bring everything that he possibly can carry out his deceptive designs. The Lord will raise up men with keen perception, who will give these truths their proper place in the plan of God. There are those who will stand true, and the question is, are you willing to stand up or are you willing to sink into oblivion? The hard thing is to find out that you are teaching Satan's lies or you're believing Satan's lies. And now is the time, during this probation, when mercy is given to repent, to take your stand on the true foundation that God has called His people to stand. Seventh-day Adventists professing true, present truth must be upholding the writings of the pioneers. Don't murmur against it. Don't delay about it. But just come and stand with those and reveal the truth in your lives. Be settled, be sealed in the truth unto salvation and eternal life. Believing the delusions of Satan will bring eternal death, eternal extinction. Meaning as if you had never existed. That's what eternal death is. Everything of sin will be wiped out. That's what the cost in believing lies is. As if you never existed. Nothing of this in the slightest changes the prophecies concerning the papacy or the apostate Protestantism when seen in the historic pioneer established position. Trust me, there are thousands upon thousands of pages written about the papacy.
True.
And trust me, they put that in a very clear light also. But this understanding of the King of the North confirms that what is said about the papacy is also true about the King of the North. It establishes things. Probation is very soon to close on all humanity. Our salvation is soon to be sealed in the courts of heaven, or our damnation will be soon sealed in the courts of heaven. How is it with your name? And I must ask, how is it with my name?
Amen.
Is your name still retained on the breastplate of your high priest? You see, if the name isn't on the high, if your name is not on the breastplate of the high priest, you're lost. You're lost. You cannot be saved if your name is not on the breastplate. Or you're going to be found wanting. Are you? It's a fearful thing to be wanting before the Lord. Don't ignore this. If this is the first time you've ever heard this, say, Lord, give me time to study it. Help me put priorities in my life so that I can study the materials that you are making available. Miracles are happening. God has provided so much for His people, and we are ignoring it at the peril of our own salvation. Will you be found wanting? Will I be found wanting? May we keep in our prayer that our name be on the breastplate of our high priest.
Amen.
Truly be our prayer that we have that closer walk with Christ day by day as time is closing. Let us stand. Believing lies that Satan has devised so that we would never know the truth. Lord, there's a reason why you inspired these men to write. There's a reason why you have given the opportunity to have these words reprinted again. For surely we see on the horizon the concluding of all prophecy and the end of probation. Help us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, that we will adjust what we do daily, that our minds will be filled with heavenly things and not earthly. Lord, help us. Strengthen us. Help us to know what we need to surrender completely to you. That our lives will be transformed into your character, the character of your Son. Perfectly reproduced that we may go home. For Lord, I am homesick and I want to go home. Let us go home, Lord. Rescue us from this pit of sin and hell. Bring us into the eternal light of your glory. Even now, this day, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.